Y'all ready? 343. Let's sing these songs. What are we playing first? 343 first. I was trying to figure, you know, I was trying to figure it out. Now, how am I going to put that one together? Hey, we would have done it. We would have made it.
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. We praise thee, O God, for the Spirit of light who has shown us our Savior. Again, fill each heart with thy love. May each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again.
Then the other one's at 413. Of course, you got to stand up and sing this song, right? 413.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner.
Tonight, I want y'all to think about something that we're going to talk about a little bit. I'm a big advocate of this. I really think that as a Christian that we need to understand who we are in Jesus. And we need to understand, too, that what we say really says who we are in Christ. If we're a Christian, here's some things that we need to do. We need to be bold about our speech about him. We can't, you know, today if you think about what's going on in this world, people are afraid to open their mouth and say anything about Jesus. You know why? Anybody got a clue why? Because you might get criticized. You know, and that's the whole deal. You might get criticized just by saying something about Christ or him or whoever, but, you know, we can't do that. We got to be bold about who we are, and we got to be careful about what we say. And we're going to be talking about our words and what it means to be a Christian tonight, but here's the deal. What you say usually is what you get. And I'll back that up by just saying this. Most of the time when you say things like, I can't do that, guess what? You're right. You can't do it because you won't do it. But if you say you can do it, guess what? You can. I mean, there's no doubt about it. You know, people says, well, why don't you go out and witness? Well, I can't do that. Well, you're right. You can't. But it's not hard to go out and witness to people on a daily basis. You know, we got all kind of avenues today that we can witness. And you know, a lot of people like this. A lot of people don't like this. But, you know, we got this thing called Facebook. You can witness on Facebook, or you can witness against Jesus on Facebook. You can say things on Facebook to people that you think that's not heard you, but and then other people see what you've said, and then guess what's happened? It gets blowed all out of proportion, and then guess what happens there? Oh, it's a mess. But you see, we as Christians, we have a great opportunity today. I don't know if y'all have noticed it or not where you live or where I live, or even in Tallahassee or Havana or Quincy or wherever. There's a lot of people out here that does not know Jesus. I mean, there are so many people. There's more, I think, that don't know him that do know him. And I wonder sometimes, I'm just talking right now until we get into what I'm going to talk about, but I just give you some things to think about tonight. For instance, you know, I said our words are very powerful. The things that we say, they really affect people, either good or bad. And you may think you're not saying, or you're saying something that's not hurting anybody, but it could. It's just like texting on your phone. You can send a text to somebody and can be totally innocent with that text, and you read that thing and you think, oh my gosh, they're mad at me. And they're not, just by the way you worded your words. And you see, that's the way it is with we as a Christian. If I tell, let's just say, for instance, if I told Jay never seen me before, and I've run into him out in the world, and I told Jay, man, I'm a Christian. You are. And then all of a sudden I start using some, you know, some choice words and everything like that. Does Jay believe that? No. Or just say this. Say I didn't tell him I was a Christian, and I'm talking to him, and I'm telling all kind of weird jokes, you know, and all this kind of stuff. And then one day he decided that he wanted to come over to BBF and go to church and say, man, he looks like he might have having a good time here. And they walk in and he sees me. Guess what? I blew it. Because I I'm standing up here, you know, and I've already told him all these dirty jokes and using some bad language. You know, he don't want to ever come back again. So I've taken the words that I could have said and done it improper to him, and I could have done it properly to him and led him to the Lord, possibly. I don't know. He's a Christian, by the way. But you see, our words are very important. Jesus said it all in all of the Gospels. If you think about what Jesus says about his words, everything that he says, I don't say anything except for what I hear my Father say. I don't do anything except for what I see my Father do. Everything that I do is because of him. And I was thinking about that today, and I was thinking about this for a long time. You know, every action that I do, everything that I do every day reflects who I am and affects whoever I'm with. Everything. Everything that I do, whether good or bad. And so, you see, if I'm going to be one of Jesus' disciples or one of his followers, then I need to act like him and do the things that he wants me to do. I was looking over in a couple of verses, different places in the Bible. Proverbs is one of the places we're going to be at, and then we're going to go to James and John. I can't just get in one book and stay there and tell you everything I need to say. I've got to go to different books to show you. But if you have your Bible and you want to turn to Proverbs chapter 18, verses 20 and 21, I want you to listen to what it says about your words. It's Proverbs 18, verses 20 and 21. This is coming out of the New King James Version, which is fine. Listen, it says, "A man's stomach shall be satisfied from the fruit of his mouth, and from the produce of his lips he shall be filled." Then number 21 says this, pretty interesting verse. It says, "Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit." What do you think that means? Anybody got a clue what you think that might mean? Anybody? I mean, just come on, don't be bashful. You know each other. You talk about everything else during the day and before we start. Now you won't say nothing. Huh? Well, you think about it. Listen to what it says. It says, "A man's stomach shall be satisfied from the fruit of his mouth, and from the produce of his lips he shall be filled." Everything that we say and do every day causes us to live or die. Everything that we partake in, it all comes from right here. You control your destiny every day when you get up, and usually it's by your mouth. You know, you get up in the morning and you decide, hey, I'm going to go to work. I'm going to get on my truck or my car or whatever, my motorcycle or bicycle or whatever. And I'm going to get on the highway and I'm going to go to work and I'm going to be a real nice fella today. I'm not going to get in anybody's way. I'm going to be really cool, calm, collective. I mean, there's nobody's going to bother me. And it's just going to be great sailing right to work. And before you get down to the stop sign, somebody has done made you mad. My mama tells me every time I go see her and I leave, she says, "Well, you be careful. There's a lot of idiots out there." And I tell her, I said, "Mama, I'm getting ready to join them because I'm one of them." But you know, it's an incredible thing. I know that in the last few, in about the last couple of years, I've noticed that the things that I say, the things that I believe, control my life. They affect my life. Not only that, they affect your life. My life affects your life. Did you know the things that I do affect you? They do. Everything that I do affects you. And you think, well, how can that be? It just does. Let me mess up one time. No, don't let me do that. But let me mess up and see what happens to the rest of you. You're going to think, okay, well, I thought Brother Tony was a Christian, and he done messed up. Well, I just don't believe he ever was. And then it just starts. And then it goes from here to there to there to there to there. And I've affected everybody here. It's like cancer. It gets on you, and it keeps growing and growing and growing. I've got to be careful what I do. I don't want to call shame on anybody here. I don't want to, you know, my goodness alive, I'd hate to know that I did something and I got in trouble and then I'd have to tell my kids, my grandkids, my mom. Oh, Lord, if I told my mama, she'd really get the switch out at me. But, you know, it's just, I got to be careful what I do. Here, let me read this to you. Go back on to verse 18. Chapter 18, verse 20, it says, "What your lips produce will fill your life." It says your lips produce five little letters, words. They produce the words that control your destiny. Guess what? If you was to get up in the morning time, and I don't know how many people do this. Maybe some of you do. Maybe some of you don't. But here's something that you could start doing if you don't do this. Get up in the morning, the first thing, right when you open up your eyes and say, "Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for letting me wake up. Thank you for just being here with me," you know. I wake up a lot during the night. And that's, I say that stuff, you know, when I wake up. And when I get up, and then when I go up and make my coffee, and I sat down and read my Bible, and I just say, thank you, Lord, for this day, and thank you for letting me be in it. And maybe I can be of some help to somebody today. Maybe I can do something good for somebody. And you know what? Usually, he'll put somebody in your path that you can help. So there's words that I've spoken today, this morning, that will affect somebody else. Nobody here, I'm just going to use this as an illustration here, but I know nobody here ever does this, but I'm sure that nobody ever gets up in the morning in a bad mood, right? Y'all don't ever get up in a bad mood, right? Everything, never? Okay, thank you. Right? Anybody here ever? I mean, right, you're okay, right? You never? Well, I'll ask you this question. How does your day start when that happens? I mean, how does it usually progress? Does it get better or does it get worse? Why does it get worse? Huh? It's an amazing thing. If you get up with a smile on your face and you get up and you get out there and you start trying to do the right things, your day usually, it's not always perfect, but it goes better than the days when you get up and you go, oh, I tell you what, I just don't know how I'm going to make it today. My back hurts, you know, my feet hurt. I just don't know what I'm going to do today. I think I'm just going to sit around. I'm going to call in sick today. I ain't sick, but I'm going to call in sick today. I did that one time, I can remember, in my lifetime. And I went uptown with somebody and to go to the bank. And I'd be doggone if my boss man wasn't right there. Wow. It's amazing how, you know, a lie will catch you. Yeah. You know? But it's our words that really affect everything that we do. Here's something else. We have to, if we want to have a life that's pleasing to God, for one thing, is that we've got to change our words. And one way to change our words is when we get into this book. Everybody got one of these? It's called the Bible. It's called God's Word. It's called, it's what we need. It's kind of like an instruction manual that you get with your car. Oh, I was at Sam's today, and I went in there, and I seen this book. It's about this thick. It's $15, and it tells me how to operate that. Well, this book is this big. This is a keyword study Bible, King James Version. It's got Strong's Dictionary, Concordance, Word Studies, Introductions, Footnotes, Red Letter Edition. Good Bible. Got the Greek, Hebrew in it. But you know, that has every answer in it that I have a question for. Every answer that I have, question that I have, it has this answer in this book here. It tells me what to do when I'm sick. Uh-oh. It tells me what to do when I'm in trouble. Well, yeah, they don't tell me to stay home. Well, yeah, I know I am my own boss, but I'm the tough one. I'm worse than any boss man. That don't work. This book has, you know, I've been talking to the choir and we were talking about some other things and talking to Jan about some different things. And one thing that I haven't done in my life that I'm going to do, I've talked to my wife about this, that we're going to do is, you know, as a Christian, I have a great opportunity. As a father, I have a great opportunity to do things to my children that a lot of people don't have this opportunity to do. And that one opportunity, and this is just a little sidebar right here, just to kind of give you an idea. That little opportunity that I had to do is that, you know, I have never ever taken my children individually and blessed them. I mean, Abraham blessed his sons. I mean, Jesus blessed us when he left out of here in Luke. I mean, I've never taken that opportunity to put my hands on my children and bless them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that they might have a prosperous life, that they might have a life filled with no problems, which problems happen, but they will have less problems, that they will have a great marriage, that they'll have great kids. And I've never blessed them like that. But guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to do that. See, this is something that I've learned that God allows me to do, is to bless my children, bless my wife, bless the choir, bless Jan as she plays, bless each one of these seats here, that people that will come and sit down in these seats will hear the Word of God, will act on the Word of God. If they don't know Jesus, they'll become a Christian, and these seats will be filled. That's the things that we have that we can do with our words that come out of our mouth. Now, that's a pretty serious deal. But most of the time, we take these words that we have, oh my goodness, and we curse our children. We'll tell them things like, you're never going to amount to anything if you don't straighten up. What has that done to your child? Huh? Huh. You know? You keep doing that and you're going to get in all kind of trouble. Guess what happens? They're going to get in all kind of problems. So you see, I've taken my words and I've used them not wisely, but unwise. When I can take my blessings and bless them and use my words correctly. My goodness alive, there's so much to this that we just don't quite understand yet. That's why it's so important for you to get so involved in this book, and you do your study in this book and see what this book tells you. The Holy Spirit of God, he don't just sit out here and do nothing. The Holy Spirit of God is waiting for you to say, show me. Jesus said, I'll send another comforter. I will send a comforter here to help you and to guide you and to show you and to guide you in the right way. He will do that. Oh my goodness. I need really about 5 hours. I know y'all don't want to stay here that long, but if we had about 5 hours, that might just scrape the dust off of a little bit of it. That's why our words are important. Here's something else I want you to listen to. In James chapter 3, let's go over here, James chapter 3. That's in the New Testament, right? Okay. Yeah, I think it is. Yeah. James chapter 3, verses 2 through 8. Listen to what it says here. This is our, I'm still talking about our words. James chapter 3, verses 2 through 8. It says, listen, for in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, in other words, if we don't offend anybody with our word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. Now, let me just quickly ask you this question. You don't have to raise your hand, but think about it. Has any man ever said anything bad to somebody else? Has anybody offended anybody here? You may not have wanted to, but you might have. Think about that. It says, but listen to this. It's verse number 3. It says, behold, it says that we put bits in the horses' mouths and that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. You ever watch that? Yeah, anybody ever rode a horse? You can pull that thing and they'll turn around like that, or they'll throw you off, one of the two. Listen, it says, behold, also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet they are turned about with a very small hymn, whithersoever the governor listeth. Have you ever noticed or ever seen the helm of a ship? The helm? Jeannie and I went up to Nag's Head, North Carolina, and got on the USS Nassau. It's 858 feet long, 250 feet wide. Huge ship. That's what Eric was on. It's an amphibious assault attack ship. And it was a parent weekend. And we got to get on that ship, and we got to sail for a day or so and spend the night. And, you know, then Eric got to get off for a little while. And as we were there, we were able to walk around the ship and go in different places. And we went up to the bridge where they drive the boat, and the captain was up there and was talking to the captain. You was with me, wasn't you? Okay. She had to take care of a lot of little girls for some reason. The mamas wasn't there. So I don't know what the deal was, but anyway, but she was with me on this one. And we got to talking, and I was watching this guy, you know, drive the ship. It's a big old wheel about this big. And the captain said, "You want to drive this thing?" "Me?" "Yeah." He said, "Okay, grab a hold to it." He said, "You see that mark right here?" I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Keep it between them two lines right there." Now, this thing's 858 foot long, and we're cruising pretty fast. And I'm over there looking at that, and that thing started going out. He said, "Oh, back to the left." I said, "Okay, just a little bit. You know, and, you know, for a little bit, I got to drive that big old boat. And I thought about, see, that's like our words. It don't take but a little word and can mess up a whole bunch. Or it can take one word and make everything great. You know, it's kind of like my words. James, I give you some advice, okay? All right, here's some advice. Tell your wife you love her all the time. Don't say, "Well, you burnt that. That wasn't very good." I know, but you will be. Okay. But it's our words that we have got to look at and make sure that we're doing right. I don't know why I said that, but I thought it was kind of nice. James, all right, let me move on. There's something that says, number five, it says, even so, the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. It don't take much to start something. It says, and the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. It don't take much for a word to change the outcome of your life, my life, this city's life, our country's. It don't take but just a little bit. One little word. It says here, let me read two more. It says, for every kind of beast and of birds and of serpents and of things in the sea is tamed and hath tamed and has been tamed of mankind. And in number 8 says this, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. How about that? It's an incredible thing to me. Just like I've been talking about, the things that we say, we do, we believe, we act on, and it's all because of what we say. What we say. let me read something here in John chapter 14. I believe it's in John chapter 14 I want to go to. No, John chapter 8. You know, Jesus, when he talked, everybody listened to him. There was people that they were amazed of everything that he would say. They just, you know, remember when Jesus was in the ship and they were going across the Sea of Galilee and the winds became boisterous, you know, and Jesus was in the ship asleep. And boy, I tell you what, them guys, them disciples, well, they were scared. They were just, couldn't figure out what was going on. And so they went up there and said, Jesus, you got to get up. We're about to drown. And I think about this a lot of times. Jesus just woke up. He said, what's going on, boys? We're about to sink. He got up, walked up to the deck of the boat, and he said, peace, be still. And all of a sudden, poof, there was a great calm on that water. And the disciples said, look at here, just with his words, the sea, the wind, obey his voice. But you see, Jesus even gave us and has given us the same type of power in our mouth, in our life, to do the same things as he did. Because Jesus says, when he goes away, that the works that he does, the same works we can do, and even greater works. So that's why I'm saying, what we say with our words affects our whole life. My goodness alive. Let me read this. John 8, verses 31 and 32. And everybody knows the scripture, or should know it. It says, then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, it says, if ye continue in my word, if ye continue my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. Now listen to what he said here. This is the word. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall what? It'll make you free. What part of that we don't understand? What part of it that we can't get that is so obvious? I mean, it is so obvious. If we know his word, it will make us free. And when we're made free, the things that Jesus wants us to do, we can do. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to tell you this, and I believe this with all my heart. I really do. You trust Jesus. You've asked him into your life. And you believe what Jesus said is true. And Jesus said you can do the same things that he did. I believe you can raise the dead. I believe you can cause people with cancer for it to disappear. I believe people that can't see could see if you believe the word that Jesus said and pray for those folks. I believe that. If you was to ask me to do that, I'd do it. But I would still, even though I believe the word, I would be afraid because of all the other words I've heard in the past saying, this don't work. You know why? You know why we think that, why we say that? This is my opinion. We have, at times, one or another, have prayed for people, and we prayed for them to get well, and they didn't, and they died. We have prayed for people for things in their life to happen, and it didn't. So what has happened is that the devil has shifted a few words into our hearts and minds saying, you see, you prayed that and it didn't work. That ain't really what Jesus said. But I'm going to tell you right here, that ain't what Jesus said. Jesus said it would work. And I believe that. I don't have a doubt in my mind about that. I've seen too many things happen here where people have been raised up. I've seen people with diseases been cured. I have friends that have been, oh my goodness, on mission trips that they've literally seen people that were blind see. And I know what I'm going to tell you, you won't believe this, but this is the honest to goodness truth. I have a friend that has been on mission trips that they've prayed for people and they've had arms grow back on. I wouldn't sit here and tell you this if it wasn't true what he told me. But that's because these people are so expectant. These people are wanting the Word of God so much in their life and they believe in what they said this is true. It's kind of new to them, but you see, I've been a Christian for what? 40 years maybe? I've had time to mellow out a little bit. I've had time to just kick back and, brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so said it wouldn't work, and it didn't work, so I don't think I need to believe that. But it's true. I'm telling you that the truth said, Jesus said, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. So if the truth will make you free, then that's what we got to believe. That's what we got to put in our hearts. These are things that I don't think that, it's going to take you a little while to grow into this. You're going to have to get here and you're going to have to study what this book says. You're going to have to understand that this is the real deal. There's nothing in it that's false. It's all true. And, I can go on and on, but I'm going to stop. But there's so much of this that, oh my goodness, we just need to believe it and do it. Let me read this to you. It says, if we're going to change the words that we speak, we need God's help. And then Jesus said, out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth will speak. So you need a new heart and you need it filled with God's word. Only in that way can your tongue be brought under complete control. Maybe we ought to just sometimes come down here and spend a couple hours on our knees and face before God and ask God to show us something, huh? It don't have to be a Sunday morning. Sunday night could be a Monday afternoon. It could be a Thursday morning, or it could be whenever. And just sit down and just pour our hearts out to God and say, God, show me something. And He will. I told you this. I'm going to tell you this one last thing. When I was in the mountains a few months ago and God spoke to me and showed me some things, it was the most incredible experience I've ever had in my entire life. I was there by myself. I sat down to pray for my meal that noonday, and the Spirit of God jumped on me so hard, I couldn't do nothing but sit there and weep in front of Him. And I asked Him things and talked to Him, and I said, God, why do you even put up with somebody like me? I'm nowhere near what I need to be for you. I'm not even what you might. And I said, this is kind of a stupid thing to say, but I said, I'm not even who you think I am. But He knows all things, right? And you know what He said? And it was just as plain as my wife was to speak to me, or Ronnie was to speak to me. He said, Tony, that's because I'm God. Ain't that something? He's God. He's it. There ain't no other. I wish I could take that, what He showed me that day, if I could rip it out of my body and just throw it into your body so you could feel what it was all about, the church would never be the same. Never be the same. My goodness alive. Oh. I gotta stop.